is that?
Okay. Thank you, Nagajima-san, for the introduction. My topic is completely different from what we are hearing for last 1.5 days. Of course, I use supercomputer for those calculations, high-level computation we use, but it is purely on chemistry, so for I address chemical problem. And before I start, I will give, people are asking where is Assam. So this is the map of India. Delhi is somewhere here. So it is extreme northeast of India is Assam. And Assam is famous for tea. You all know the 55% of all tea is produced in Assam. And also we have Kaziranga National Park, which is famous for one horned rhino. We have about 2,500 rhinos. In fact, it was only in 74, there were only 14 rhinos. Then the government made some plan to preserve those rhinos. Now it has gone up to 2,500. And from my university is only 60 kilometers. This park is only 60 kilometers. So every year I visit, and whenever I get a visitor, I take to Kaziranga National Park. Now I will talk about metals and metal oxide nanoclusters. Why they are important, that nanoclusters of metal and metal oxides are very useful in chemistry as catalysts. They can be used heterogeneous catalysts or photocatalysts. They can be used in solar cell. They have also magnetic properties. This has been found application in recording media, components of manufacturer of different electronic devices. They can be used as sensors, or there is something called ferrofluids. So magnetic nanoparticles are used. These nanoparticles are also used as labeling agent and carriers in biology. And they can be also used to control release of drug delivery. So they have various applications. And then metal oxide nanoparticles, they are very good as heterogeneous catalysts, as they exhibit acid-base and redox properties. They catalyze many reactions very selectively. And then they can be also used as they can be supported on various metal oxides. And these supported metal oxides give stability to the nanoparticles. And in my laboratory, I have also an experimental group. So we synthesize metal oxide nanoparticles of metals. And we use for those things in various reactions. And this is just to highlight that this paper was published in 2014. And in 2015 editorials. The last issue of 2015 editorials has been highlighted, one of the most cited articles on nanoparticles. We also use nanoparticles for removing water pollutants. There are various organic pollutants in water, so you use them for removing those nanoparticles to degrade those chemicals. Our things in our once we synthesize nanoparticles, we try to determine the structure. But unfortunately, structure of nanoparticles cannot be determined or very, very difficult to determine with the help of experiment. So we don't know what is the structure of those nanoparticles. TEM or SEM will give the some class size of the nanoparticles, but it cannot give the exact structure of the cluster. So in that regards, we need to use computational methods. So computer can have very significant information. The prediction of nanoclusters is fundamental importance using computational method. Chemical and physical properties of nanoclusters are substantially different from the bulk phase, phases. bulk phase, we can get the structure from different techniques. But for nano clusters, it is very difficult. Understanding possible structural changes as a function of size of nanoclusters. Nanoclusters, the size can vary, the number of particles can vary from 3 to 100. And depending on the size, the structure of the nanocluster changes. And these only using computational method, we can get the structure of those. Obtaining structural information of nanocluster from experiment is extremely difficult, as I told earlier. So it is very, very difficult. So we need to use computational techniques. Now in computational techniques, you all are aware of this problem of global minima. How to get the most minimum structure of this? So it is, if we use conventional method, we always end up with local minima. And for global optimization, so we have used one program which was developed at University College London. And that program has several algorithms using Monte Carlo Bayesian hopping method, random quenching, simulated annealing, genetic algorithm, and particle swap algorithm. And today, whatever I will be presenting, so in this calculation, we have used genetic algorithm for getting the global minimum. The name of the program is called Knowledge-Led Master Code, KLMC. It was developed by Scott Woodley from University College London. I have a collaboration with him, and he visited my laboratory, also Kaziranga. And then they gave me that program and also access to supercomputer facilities in Scotland, which is called ARSAR. And these calculations are done mostly in those supercomputers. This is the algorithm for the KLMC program. We can generate several, for one particular structure, we can generate about 50 different structures randomly. We can optimize or pre-optimize using atomistic potential, one program called GALP, General Utility Lattice Program, or we can also do DFT calculation, density functional calculation. We have used FHIM program for DFT calculation. And then we check for the stability. So first of all, I'll present some of our results on zinc oxide, potassium fluoride clusters, then cadmium selenate clusters, and also magnesium oxides. These two are important in catalysis. This potassium fluoride is used as brazing in aluminum, and cadmium selenate used in solar cells. Another important characteristic is cadmium selenate is strongly polarizable, and potassium fluoride is weakly polarizable, and zinc oxide and magnesium oxides are in between. So we can say that changes in properties from strongly polarizable to weakly polarizable clusters. So here we have seen this cadmium selenate is the structure for n is equal to 3. We have 6 atoms. The structure is like at a triangle, but when it comes to potassium fluoride, it becomes a ring structure like a benzene. And then these are the properties in the literature and the calculated properties, bond length, and then angles. And cadmium selenide has weakest bond, zinc oxide, magnesium oxide, second and third weakest, whereas potassium fluoride has strongest bond. From the bond energy calculation, we can get this information. Then we can we have gone to higher clusters, say 8 to 10 atom clusters. The n is equal to 4 means 8, and n is equal to 5 is 10 atom cluster. GM is called global minima. So global minimum for N is equal to 4, zinc oxide and cadmium selenide have ring structure. So zinc oxide and these are having ring structure. Whereas global minimum for magnesium oxide and potassium fluoride are having cuboid structures. From a potassium fluoride cuboid to a selenide ring, there is a change. And then similar structure we got for cadmium selenide, magnesium oxide, and potassium fluoride. But zinc oxide is still planar, so it is a two-dimensional structure. For when n is equal to 5, cadmium selenide become three-dimensional, magnesium oxide become three-dimensional, potassium fluoride also become three-dimensional, but zinc remained in two-dimension. Then we have presented the structure of 12 to 14 atom clusters, n is equal to 6 and n is equal to 7. Again, zinc oxide is still planar, two-dimensional. Even at n is equal to 7, zinc oxide is planar. So zinc oxide 2D ring motif as global minima. For n is equal to 6, magnesium oxide is having a drum, and a two-ring structure. And then tube and rock salt for this is tube kind and this is rock salt. And zinc oxide we got planar till at n is equal to 7. There is a change in from two dimensional to three dimensional structure when n is become 8. So zinc oxide become three dimensional structure only when we have 16 atoms in the cluster. And this is again drum kind of structure. This is magnesium oxide is called rock salt kind of structure here. And similar is for potassium fluoride. Then for n is equal to 10, magnesium oxide and potassium fluoride. This is the global minima. Second one is next highest, and third one is next highest. These are the energies we have put, the difference in energy compared to the global minimum one in electron volt. Magnesium oxide and potassium fluoride have same motif as their global minimum. However, L2 for magnesium oxide has become L3 in potassium fluoride. The GM for magnesium oxide 11 and L2 for potassium are similar. Similarities between magnesium and fluoride, calcium fluoride continues. So this is the last of this series of clusters. So we perform calculation up to n is equal to 12, where we have 24 atoms. Similarity between this, here we have a drum kind of structure, and here we have drum kind of structure in L. This is just above the global minimum, but we call it LM2, the local minimum 2. So local minimum 2 of magnesium oxide is similar to the global minimum of potassium fluoride, and LM3 are similar for both potassium fluoride and magnesium oxide. Then now we present some of the properties of the global minimum. So we charge for the global minimum. Then we'd like to see the properties, how the properties of those global minimum varies. So here we put the energy per cluster. So this is defined as En minus N. This is also called binding energy, En minus NE1. E1 is the energy of magnesium oxide or potassium fluoride. So that difference we are plotting here with the clusters from 1 to 12. So when we move, say this is for magnesium oxide, so it is decreasing with the cluster size and it is approaching towards the bulk value, which is about minus 7.64 eV. So here it is, we have 6 is the scale. So if we go keep on going, so it will reach the bulk value of this one. And in cluster sense, there is another property which is defined as second difference to energy, second energy difference or second difference SED, which is defined by this twice of E, and this equation is given here. So this tells about the stability. So we have got different clusters. Now when these clusters are synthesized, which cluster has the probability of synthesizing maximum? So from magnesium oxide, so we found that when N is equal to 4, say N is equal to 4 is 1, N is equal to 6, drum kind of drum cluster, 4 was cuboid, and N is equal to 9, tube. So these three clusters are having maximum stability. So this means that when someone synthesizes magnesium oxide nanoparticles, the probability of forming N is equal to 4, N is equal to 6, and N is equal to 9 are maximum. So similarly, we can predict for other cluster, which cluster will have maximum probability. So here we are plotting distance, average distances and average coordination number. Now if we saw there is an increase in the beginning from 1 to 2, and then it is steady for zinc oxide. The red one is zinc oxide. It is steady and again change in here. The average coordination number per atom. So this indicates that this one was one-dimensional cluster. And here it is two-dimensional. And two-dimensional cluster remains up to N is equal to 7, as we have seen in our clusters. So up to N is equal to 7, two-dimensional clusters remains. And then it become three-dimensional at N is equal to 8. So as the coordination number changes, there is a change from 1D to 2D to 3D. So similar trend, say for here for potassium fluoride, the three-dimensional structure started early at N is equal to 3. So we can predict the change in structure from 1D, 2D to three-dimensional. The average bond length also increases when dimensionality of the cluster increases, but gradually decreases with increase in N. So dimensionality means from say 1D to 2D, there is a change in bond length, and then it remains 2D, so it decreases with the increase in the size. Again, it will increase when it converted to three-dimensional cluster. So these are the homolomo energy, because when we want to use these metal particles for various chemical applications, so we need to see when in bulk calculation we generally put the band gap, but in cluster calculation we put the homolomo energy and their differences. For zinc oxide, their homolomo changes in homolomo energy shows a transition between N is equal to 7 to 8. Say zinc oxide, there is a change from 7 to 8. The 7 is 3.28 electron volt, then suddenly it is decreases. So this also indicates for the change in structure, which directly correlates with the 2D to 3D transition. Similarly, the 2D, 3D transition cluster at N is equal to 3 to 4 for magnesium oxide seen. The smaller 3D structure for magnesium oxides are observed to have smaller delta E. Then we put homolomo energy for potassium fluoride clusters and cadmium selenate structure. And these experimental values are, these are the experimental values, A, B, C, we have put here. The calculated delta E for potassium fluoride is nearly constant at about 5 for everywhere, which is about half of the bulk value. Bulk value is about 10.9. For cadmium selenide, so this is one reported value of nanocluster 3. So our values are also close to that values. Now, then we optimize various other nanoclusters like nickel oxide, cesium oxide, tin oxide using KLMC program. We use GALP and then ORC FHI AIIMS and ORCA software for DFT calculation. So I will quickly present some of those. This is on selenium oxide, ceria oxide, and these are the structure, and these are the up to n is equal to 20 we have calculated. This is n is equal to 10, and then we put up to n is equal to 20. These are all calculated using DFT and with the help of program FHIM. Then the energies, I think the difference of energy will be the homolumo differences. We have so these are not yet analyzed properly because this part is not yet published. Just now we have completed those calculations. Change in homolumo energy will give the stability of those clusters. These three clusters will be more, will have maximum stability. Then we here it is binding energy per atom. It is decreasing with the increasing cluster size. Then second difference in energy we have plotted here. This is second difference in energy, showing the stability of the clusters which will form when we synthesize these materials. We also perform some calculations on nickel oxide nanoparticles because nickel oxide nanoparticles has wide range of applications like manufacturing magnetic materials, alkaline battery, dye synthesis, solar cells, semiconductors, SOFC, anti-ferromagnetic layers, P-type. So there are several applications of nickel oxide nanoparticles. These are the clusters which we have optimized and so we need supercomputer for generating these clusters because I am showing only first three clusters, global minima, next higher. But we generated 50 different clusters of each nano size. So without the help of supercomputer, we cannot perform these calculations. And then we studied the magnetic properties of some of the cluster using ORCA program. And these are the theories. This is the zero field split. This is the Hamiltonian for how we define the zero field splitting. We put spin orbit coupling calculation and spin-spin coupling. And then we'll go to the some of the results here. So this is the G-tensor and D-tensor values. G-tensor values, positive means they are not good as nanomagnet. But when D-tensor values are negative, those clusters can be used as nanomagnet. And these are the G-values, which are different from the values of free electron. The free electron, and these values, I think I put 2.something. Yeah, this is 2.0023. So our calculated values are having different from the free electron. So in addition to those calculations, in my group, we work on several. As I told, we synthesize zeolite materials, another metal, another oxide, metal oxides. And we put several drug molecules, complexes inside zeolites and do catalysis experimentally. Then we put metal nanoparticles inside zeolite and do a lot of catalysis reactions. We model metal oxides. Then we also work on carbon nanotubes. And we have attached some of the drug molecules. This is drug molecules for anti-malaria, it is a pyrazinamide drug molecules, and then we do docking, then molecular dynamics in protein, and study their interactions. So this is the activity in my group. So these are some of the clusters of gold nanoclusters and the properties, and then we use those nanoparticles for removal of carbon monoxide. So carbon monoxide is an air pollutant. So we need to, I think one Japanese person, Professor Haruta, he was pioneer of developing gold nanoparticles for removing carbon monoxide. He was the first person to do experiment on CO oxidation using methyl nanoclusters. So we studied their reaction mechanism. Then we also used palladium nanoparticles of various structure we optimized at DFT level, and then perform reactions, how the reaction take place with oxygen. These are the mechanisms we propose. How palladium 4 new cationic, anionic, and neutral can have can catalyze the CO oxidation reaction. And then, so I'll not go into details of this. Then we also concentrated on removal of methane. Conversion of methane to methanol. So methane is the most stable hydrocarbon. So activation of methane is very difficult. So we use nano clusters or nano particles to activate methane and convert methane to methanol. These are the mechanism of so detailed mechanism I have not. This is the various steps involved in the mechanism of methane to methanol conversion. So this is my final one, where we do control release of drug delivery using carbon nanotube. This is a fullerene. Fullerene is used when we use fullerene alone, it is sitting inside the nanotube. If we use the drug molecule alone, it will stay inside the cluster. But if we use both fullerene and drug molecules, one by one, it will come out from the nanotube. So this is used for control release of drug delivery, and we are working on this using molecular dynamics. So I thank, these are my groups, and I thank Professor Kimiko Hirao for giving me the opportunity to present my work here, also hosting my GST-JSPS lecture tour program. So I am in a visit to Japan for 15 days, and I have started from Kobe. So from tomorrow onwards, I'll be in different places giving lectures on catalysis or computational methods in catalysis. And I'm very much thankful to Professor Hirao for hosting my application. I also thank Professor Richard Catlow and Dr. Scott Woodley, who provided me the software as well as hardware facilities at supercomputer facilities in Scotland. And I thank all of my students. I think most of the calculations were carried out by Pakiza and then Nobonita and Devojiti. I thank GST and JSPS for funding my trip to Japan. Thank you very much for your kind attention.